Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions, putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Developing My Loving Self group and is part of an Education in Love series. In My Choice to Be My Loving Self presentation, Jesus examines the need to fully express our personality and emotions, to desire connection with the other half of ourselves, the personal priorities we must set, and the choices that we will make to be the most loving expression of ourselves. Recorded on the 28th of May, 2016, in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
When Mary and I were preparing these sessions, when we got to the last 2 days, we were just saying, there's not enough days. And not enough days, because we felt that some of this material would be really good to have more questions about it, but haven't got enough time to fit it in. So you'll have to send in those questions via the FAQ channel so that we can answer them that way. Okay, my choice to be my loving self. Notice here that the focus is on being my loving self rather than developing my loving self. So previous session was more about developing, what do I need to develop my loving self. This is more about being your loving self in all circumstances and situations. So my choice to be my loving self is our topic for conversation. Okay, now firstly I'd like to talk to you about the way in which you use your will, in particularly in two different areas, if you're going to be your loving self. The first area is the way you use your will with your regard to your priorities. Priorities. A person who loves themselves has a very clearly defined set of priorities within themselves. Now, this clearly defined set of priorities is inside of every single person who becomes a celestial spirit, every single person who becomes at one with God. There's a clearly defined set of priorities. And the way in which they express these priorities is different depending on their personality and their nature, and also depending on their experience. But they all have these priorities. And they all have these priorities in this order as well. So the priorities are quite simple. The first priority, priority number one, relationship with God. It sounds really simple, right? Relationship with God, when you say it like that. But the reality is, for the majority of us, relationship with God is not priority number one. In fact, for the majority of you, relationship with either yourself or the other half of yourself is priority number one. And usually relationship with God for most people is priority number 1,000, you know. But what happens is as you grow and change, and particularly as you recognize that you need an education from God, your priority with God starts raising until it actually goes beyond your priority to have a relationship with anyone else. And it's this priority of putting your relationship with God first that is going to dictate a lot of your actions and behavior. Can you see why? You see, if You see, for the majority of us, if we don't have our relationship with God first, then what happens is that we automatically start doing a number of unloving things after that. And a loving person must finish up putting their priority with God to be number one. It's going to be the thing that drives you through most of the things you're going to need to address. Because a lot of the things you're going to need to address are scary. Like there's this global fear, terror, it's terror, terrified. A lot of it's going to be painful. You're going to need to work your way through some emotional pain, and some of that pain is quite intense at times. And unless you have something that drives you through it and gets you through it, you won't do it. And what about when it comes to codependent addictions with partners? How are you going to get through those if you don't put your relationship with God first? Because your codependent addiction is where one is feeding the other and each person is happy about feeding the other's addictions. The only thing that's going to make you dissatisfied in a codependent relationship is the fact that your relationship with God isn't happening. And your relationship with God can't develop while you're in codependent addiction with your partner. And so what happens is the pain of not having the relationship with God causes you to realize that no, you've got to deal with these codependent addictions with your partner. So the relationship with God is the highest, needs to become the highest priority in order for you to get through everything you're going to need to go through in order to be your loving self. And if it doesn't have priority, you will compromise. You'll compromise truth. You'll compromise faith. You'll compromise taking loving action. You'll decide to not feel emotions. You'll do everything you can to weasel out of different situations when they become too painful. And in the end, unless this relationship is the highest priority for you, you won't get through those particular problems. You just won't. So it's a key part, the most important part of your progress if you want to become loving and be loving. The next thing, obviously, is your relationship with self. And maybe what we need to do is write some of this a little differently. My love for God and my love of self is another way of writing it. So my love for God will pull me through, drive me through all sorts of situations. The second is my relationship with myself. Now remember what self is. What is self again? Me and my other half as one soul, isn't it? That's self. So if we're talking about loving self, many of you think you can love yourself without loving the other half of yourself. And you can't. Right? You need to develop a love of the other half of yourself, a desire for that other half of yourself, right? As well as a love of yourself, not compromising love of self. Being your loving self requires you to actually love yourself and express love towards yourself. Many of us ride ourselves into the ground. Or, opposite to that, we put ourselves above everyone else around us. So we do one or the other. We deprecate ourselves, we feel inferior to others, or we treat ourselves as superior to others. Either way, you're not loving self. And loving self, we need to make the choice to put a priority on loving self. And what I noticed with myself, that's a lot of selves here, with myself is that this has been one of my most difficult areas of work. You'll find, and I feel many of you will find either that you treat yourself as too important or treat yourself as not important enough, either one of those two things in different subjects and situations, rather than having just a consistent love for self. And learning the lessons of love of self are very important lessons to learn. Very important lessons to learn. Because that also enables you to live in the world even if nobody loves you. So most of us are very against the idea or concept that nobody has to love us. In fact, it's called, you know, in most psychological circles, it's called the need to be loved. And I'm basically saying that the need to be loved is out of harmony with love. That's what I'm saying. If you love yourself, you will not need love expressed from another, other than God, of course. Does that make sense? You will not be needy for love. So this is a very big priority. We need to put that as a high priority if we're going to be our loving selves. The third priority is our relationship with others, of course. And so we could call this my love for everyone. My love for others, my love for everyone. Needs to be a priority. It's more important to you than doing things like becoming a vegan. Although becoming a vegan involves love of self, it's really just love of your physical body that you're expressing. Love of others is more important than becoming a vegan, because the next priority, the fourth priority, is relationship with the environment. And that's where becoming a vegan fits in. Does that make sense? So that's my love for the environment. So they are my priorities. Really, not much else matters than those four things. Not much else matters. You get those four things right in the right order, internally, inside of yourself, emotionally, you're guaranteed to be happy. Yvonne, thanks for you come to joy down here.
Thanks. If you're saying receiving God's love is the key to becoming loving, then how does that work for the spirits or the people on the natural love path who become loving by the sixth sphere?
It's very hard for them to become loving. They have to do that, all that willpower stuff, and try hard, and they're trying to develop a relationship with themselves without knowing the other half of themselves and knowing the other half exists, and they're having to try to love others without having a part of God's love inside of them. It makes it easier to love others, and God's love inside of them, because God's love is not inside of them, their treatment of the environment is quite often frequently quite bad, and they've got to work their way through those issues. So there's all the same issues to address, but they have no love of God to help them to do it. So it's very, very difficult. And that's why it takes many years for most of them to reach that condition. It takes many years. And much longer in most cases to reach the sixth dimension than it takes for a person who's on earth to reach the celestial condition. Right? If you look at the Robert James Lee's books, Afra took 1 year or something like that to reach the seventh or celestial sphere condition. And the average person who passes from Earth takes much longer than that to reach the sixth sphere condition without God.
Yeah.
Much longer. Because it requires more effort, a lot of willpower. They still have to deconstruct this, but they don't know how to release their pain because they think it's about suppressing their pain. And so a lot of it's about what they call forgiveness, but... And repentance, but what they do is they go into a place of forgetfulness, and what that means is that time eventually causes you to be so distant from the original issue that you forgot the original issue exists. And so we're talking about significant periods of time now, like for the majority of them, Yeah, very, very rare for a person to reach the sixth sphere condition, you know, less than 100 years usually or so. And therefore they still have exactly the same limitations. They can never be at one with their soulmate, they can never be at one with God, they don't enjoy the conditions of bliss that the celestial spirits enjoy, they don't have their power, and all of those other disadvantages also still occur. But it took them much longer to get there. So there's the priorities. You can see that's an expression of your will, isn't it? Setting your will to develop your priorities in that regard. Yep. Now in your notes there's a lot of just detail about those different priorities, about why those priorities are essential. We won't go through them now because there's quite a lot of material to cover in this talk. We need to now work through the choices that we need to make as well. And what we're doing here is just summarising a few basic choices that we need to make in order to be our loving self. So what I'm suggesting is, to be your loving self requires a relationship with God. And any person who does not have a relationship with God is not, in the end, going to be their loving selves. And I'm suggesting to you that every sixth sphere spirit who's in the sixth dimension, they are not yet their loving selves. They are not even yet themselves, because they can't unify with the other half of their soul even. So they can't even ever, ever be themselves. While they make the choice to reject God's love, they will never be themselves. Interesting, isn't it? Probably haven't thought of it that way, but that's how it is. They will never, ever be themselves, because they can never exist in a unified state, in the soul union state with their soulmate, without God's love. So they'll never be themselves. They don't even know really how to have this unadulterated emotional connection with the other half of themselves. They don't even, can't even do that. That's one of the penalties, you could say, which is associated with sin against the Holy Spirit, sinning against God's love. So the next thing is what is the choices we need to make, what kind of choices or decisions we need to make. So let's have a look at the choices. Here we're only listing a few choices. The first one is to be the expression of your personality and nature. To actually choose to, you know, instead of peeking out from behind the curtain occasionally and displaying yourself to the world in very rare occasions, you decide to just jump out and be yourself in all your glory. Or not, depending on where you are at the time, right? That's what you decide to do. So it's about being your personality and nature. Dave, you'd like to ask?
And that's about being my personality and nature right now, right here, right now.
Yep.
At any given moment.
Yep. Yep. So when I first met you, Dave, is a good illustration. When I first met you, all you were what the spirits told you to be. The spirits around you, they just told you to be something every day, and that's what you were. And honestly, anybody who knew that was going on knew, I'm just never going to get Dave here. I'm just going to get what the spirits tell him to be all the time. And that's because you give away your will, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. And so that's a big problem, because it means that no matter what interactions we have, I'm never going to get you. Right? And that's really sad for me as well as for you.
Yeah. Yeah. It's always going to be somebody else, not
yeah.
me.
Yeah. Yeah. Not you. And so learning to be you in all circumstances and situations is a very important factor. And we'll talk about that a bit more later, about being your personality, you know, what that means. My choices need to use my will in harmony. Whoops. Well, let's just say lovingly, shall we? After the first week of presentation last time, and after this week, you should be starting to get the idea how much you need to engage this loving will, shouldn't you? You can see that understanding your will, understanding how you use it, how to use it lovingly are key things for you with your future development. You will not grow in harmony with love. You not become my loving your loving self, develop your loving self without learning how to use your will lovingly. And this is God's definition of loving, isn't it, too? So that it's going to require an adjustment in our belief systems associated with what we believe love to be compared to what God knows love to be. And we then use our will in harmony with that. And it's going to feel very strange for many of you doing that because we've only been doing this, which is using our will in harmony with the world's definition of love. Does that make sense? So what we got to do is change from using our will in harmony with our personal and world definition of love, and really that is a lot to do with our parents' definition of what love is, isn't it? Instead of doing that, we now use our will in harmony with what our true parent's definition of love is. So you see, what we've done is we've substituted these earthly parents who had a factor, a very, very short factor in creating our two bodies, right? And we've called them parents, and then we've done everything we can to believe that what they believe when our real parent, God, has the definition of love that's true that we need to connect to. And so what we've done is we've gone this way, the world's definition of love, a parent's definition of love, and that's going to have to all be adjusted, and to adjust that needs our will has to be engaged. Without our will, won't be able to be engaged. Third thing we need is we need to accept positive influences. Shall we call them accept loving influences? So these are not people who feed your addictions, are they? So this is not saying, oh, this person makes me feel nice. That feels really nice. So I'll accept their stuff, right? It's not that. It's accepting what God's definition of a loving person is and finding those people. And remember, the loving influences include God. They include God, celestial spirits, spirits who are on the path already, ahead of you on the path, people on earth who are also in a loving state ahead of you on the path. They are all loving influence, and we need to accept them. What does it mean to accept them? Well, instead of arguing with them and fighting with them about everything and, you know, saying, oh, and not trusting them, right? We would learn to stop arguing, start considering, stop fighting, start listening, wouldn't we, if we were going to accept those kind of influences? I see many of you arguing with loving influences or rejecting loving influences, in other words, and accepting unloving influences. So that's not going to work very well, is it? So that brings us to the next one, and that is to reject unloving influences. There's a Bible verse that says, do not be misled. Bad associations spoil useful habits. So when Paul, the Apostle Paul, wrote that, he knew that most of you would be misled. Does that make sense? He knew that. He knew that most of us would think, let's go to get the approval of the unloving influences. See, that's where our addictions tell us to go. So if someone's nasty to you, you appease them. You try to get their approval, because if you don't get their approval and appease them, they'll attack you. You don't want that. So what you do is you appease them. So what do we finish up doing? We're actually accepting the unloving influence of that person by doing that, by appeasing people who are out of harmony with love because of their potential for violence or their potential for attack or their potential for disapproval or their potential for judgment and so forth. By appeasing them, we are actually accepting their influence. Well, you can't be your loving self. You can't be yourself while you're accepting unloving influences from other people. You are going to degrade yourself if you do that. So it's very important to understand that. And yet I see many of you have that flipped around. You're accepting unloving influences and rejecting loving influences. In fact, I often hear people say, oh, that person who I know to be quite loving is so judgmental. And I'm going, I'm not judgmental. What's this person thinking? This person has obviously got a bit of feedback from them that they didn't like, and then think, oh, I'm going to reject that, and I'm just going to call that person unloving, and that's my tool for rejecting it. And I'm going, but that person is quite loving. That person treats you nicely. Why are you rejecting their influence? It's crazy. You're just making things worse for yourself doing that. There's an old saying, you know the saying, birds of a feather flock together. Well, I don't know if I agree with that saying. What I've actually noticed is that people who have been abused and rejected and disapproved of generally, for some reason, continue to associate with the kind of people who will continue to disapprove of them, reject them, and treat them badly. They do. And that doesn't make any sense, but that's what we do. We've been taught to accept that those gaining the approval of those persons is one of the most important things we need to do for our own survival. That's what we've been taught. And as a result of that, We try to get their approval, we try to get their acceptance, all the while not realizing that we're actually accepting an unloving influence in our life. What I've learnt is there's plenty of people who will try to unlovingly influence you. Many of you have tried to unlovingly influence me, even without being aware of it. Many of you get manipulated by spirits to try to unlovingly influence me. And if that's what happens to a group of people who feel their intentions are well set, what do you think happens to people whose intentions are manipulative and evil, wanting to harm people? They're so easily influenced to attack you, so easily influenced. You've got to stop listening to them. You've got to stop believing them. You've got to reject their unloving influences if you want to be yourself. See, if I accept their unloving influences in any situation, what I will do is I will conform. See, I'll put on this, won't I? I'll put on the facade. I'll conform to what they demand of me. And straight away, I'm not my loving self now. I'm not even myself at all anymore. I'm now in a state of conforming, manipulating my true self to be whatever I feel they want me to be. It's like the old song, you know. You can't please everyone, so you've got to please yourself. And after a while, you learn that if you attempt to please everyone, everyone has completely different definitions of love. They have completely different false beliefs. You try to please everyone. To do that, you're going to have to turn on a facade for every person. You're going to have to. And if you turn on a facade for any person, you are not yourself. So you can't be yourself. So this is will-based choices need to make. That will help me be who I really am. Right there. No question about that? Joy, you want a question about that?
What does God's love do that makes us to discern whether someone's loving or unloving?
Well, quite a lot of things actually, Joy. When God's love enters you, it's like it's a barometer, like a temperature gauge, if you like. And what happens is that every time something in comparison to the amount of love that has entered us, everything gets compared internally to the amount of love that's entered us. And so every question we ask, every truth we discuss, every error we discuss, every item of knowledge we see, every emotion that we feel, it all gets measured against what God's love thinks about that thing, what God's love feels about that thing. Does that make sense? Internally, that's what happens. So the beauty of that is that it means that I automatically now can sense through this emotional engagement with God's love, because I've had some of God's love entered me, I can now automatically feel what's in and what is out of harmony with that love, because that love is now in me. Mm. Yeah? And you can imagine how powerful that is. Mm. Yeah.
And does that become stronger as you receive more of God's love?
Of course. Just the more of God's love you receive, it's like the barometer becoming more refined. More refined each time, more refined, until such a point that it's so refined that any single thing that's out of harmony with God's love, whether it's in the environment, inside of a person, you can feel it. Right? Now, along with it comes other gifts, as we've discussed, including the gift of being able to feel the other person accurately, to be able to feel and also read their thoughts. So you now not only know what the person does, whether it's loving or not, but also even what they think. Does that make sense? And what's happened to them, everything. And because that's what God's love can do. Yeah, it's very, very powerful. Yeah, very powerful. Good question. Okay, so we've talked about our priorities. We've talked about our choices. I'm trying to go look at this because there's far too much material here for me to cover. So I'm just going to have to select the material through this outline, unfortunately. So we talked a little about expressing our personality, but let's have a look at it in more detail. Now, this issue pertains to this emotion, doesn't it? Remember that? Expressing our real nature and personality is one of our primal fears. Yep. So obviously, to do this, we're going to have to start going through this. You see the relationship? If we are going to express our personality and nature, we're going to have to feel some of the terror about expressing our personality and nature. Now, to confront terror, there's a couple of ways, isn't there? One is to actually do something and then let yourself feel the results of what you just did. So for many of us, what you are doing with your life is you're going, okay, I'm meant to be myself. So you tell yourself that you're meant to be yourself. So what you try to do is you try to work out what that is and then be that. That's not what we're suggesting here. What we're suggesting here is if you feel your global terror and engage what you feel like you should do in every situation, be honest and truthful with every single person in every situation, that global terror will automatically start coming up, right? It will. You'll start, and the key is to allow yourself to experience it, to feel it. Once it's released from you, being yourself will be easier. Now, if you've deconstructed, if you've accepted and deconstructed your facade, you already know what is not the real you. So, you know, you might go along to an event and all of a sudden you're the life of the party, and then after all you go, hey, I'm being the life of the party. This is me not being me again. This is what I just feel I need to do in this situation, right? And then you get with your mother and you just say, yes, mum, yes, mum, yes, mum, yes, mum, yes, mum, yes, mum, no worries, mum. Okay, catch you later, mum, right? And then you go away from that situation and you go, oh, I wasn't myself again. That was me just pandering to mum's need to tell me what to do and so forth. Yeah. And then with your dad, it's the same. You go to work and it's like, you know, you're the tough, might be the tough sort of, you know, cool person. Then you realise, oh, I'm just trying to be cool now. Like, that's not the real me either, right? You have the option of, once you've worked your way through these things, you notice yourself attempting to do these things to fit in with the world around you, and you stop doing them because you realise that expressing your real nature and personality needs to be done unapologetically. Needs to be done without fear of consequence. Now, you imagine getting to that point. Wouldn't it be fantastic? Where you could just be you, don't even have to think. You're walking down, everything you choose to do, you just choose to do it and you be you, and you're not even thinking about, what does that person think of me? What does this person think of me? You get up in front of 100 people and you're not worried about what everybody's thinking of you. You're not hyper-sensitive and hyper-alert, worried about what will happen in any situation. You have an important meeting and you treat it exactly the same as if it was just a meeting with your friend. So the queen asks you to go to her palace. You rock up there with some bare feet and some shorts and a t-shirt. Say, how you doing? If that's how you normally would greet a person, that's what you do. Because you're not afraid of being judged, criticized, kicked out. You're just yourself. What a relaxing place, eh? Yeah. And it is. It's a lot easier than doing this. This one is like, I have to be this way with Diane, I have to be this way with Janine, I have to be this way with Ali, I have to be this way with Mary, because she's special, so she's got... I've got to be the, you know, a certain way with her that's different to everyone else. And it's really quite confusing. And then you get all of those people in one room and what do? That's exhausting. Then you've got to have some kind of internal priority system that goes, Mary's more important than Diane, so I'll do my Mary thing this time. Or, you know what I mean? It's like, it's all weird, isn't it, when you think about it? But that's what we do. Kelly, you don't think.
So in the meantime, we're going to be a very messy personality.
Yeah, yeah. It's going to be like a combination of bits of facade here and bits of real self there. And sometimes you won't even know which bit is the real bit. Then you work it out, you know, through your experimentation and you're making mistakes. You work it all out and you go, oh, well, this bit's unloving, so obviously that's out of harmony with love, therefore it must be my facade. But, yeah, it can be messy. But see, this is the thing, is that most of you are going, like, what are you doing?
Juggling.
How hard is it to continue juggling in your life?
Yeah, exhausting.
It's exhausting. Now, what do most of you need to do is this. So you're doing this, right? This is what you're doing now, and then you just... That's what you need to do. Just drop it all. Surrender. Drop it all.
So we have to feel at least a good percentage of that, our terror, to be then expressing mostly our personality until we... fully ourselves.
And it's a gradual thing. You start out feeling very little of your real self. Mm-hmm. And then as you proceed and let yourself, you know, usually it becomes a gradual thing. But it doesn't have to be a gradual thing if you think about it, because we could choose to just embrace it and be done with the results, couldn't we? We could have some courage just to choose to just step into what we know our real self is. And you know when you're modifying yourself, you do. Most of the time you do know. You know, I'm uncomfortable here, I don't like it here, I don't like it there, I don't feel like it's good here now, but I'm sitting here because I feel like I have to. You know when you're doing all those things, do the opposite to that. And I've found as a general principle, just do the opposite of what you feel like doing. Because what you feel like doing is generally your facade and addictions in play, because when we start, that's how it is. So what I decided to do in many cases was just do the opposite. So I didn't feel like going shopping, so I went to go shopping. I didn't feel like being home, so I stayed home. You know? I didn't feel like being alone, so I was alone. I didn't feel like spending any time with people, so I went and spent some time with people. Just confront the addictions that are in play. I didn't feel like patting a cat, so I pat a cat. Right down to just stuff like that. It's amazing what you learn. Yeah. Didn't feel like exposing my heart, so I exposed my heart. Didn't feel like telling the truth, so I tell the truth. When you begin, you can pretty much assume, can't you? That pretty much every action is driven by facade and addiction. So if you do the opposite, then it's going to confront something. I've found doing opposites have worked fantastic for me for a large part of my progression.
Thank you.
Okay. So expressing your personality. Let's have a look. God's love is the thing that helps me be myself. The reason why it helps me be myself is quite obvious if you think about it. If God loves me only when I'm myself, can you see that will drive me to be myself all the time? Once you've received a little bit of God's love and you realize that it's only there when you're choosing to be yourself, that's going to cause you to choose to be yourself. Do you see? And if God's love is more important to you, if God's love and loving God is more important to you than anything else, then you won't care if joy attacks me. Well, that's joy's issue, you know. If joy attacks me for being myself, and I've still got God giving me love for being myself, do you think joy's attack will matter much to me? Will it? It won't. I'd barely probably feel it or consider it. And it's not about ignoring her or anything. It's just the fact that God's love is more important. I can feel God's love entering me when I'm myself. So that's going to drive me to be myself. Isn't that true? See, most of you haven't tried that, but that's what happens. We need to get to the stage where we can live in this world where we are the only person who loves ourselves, and we're still okay living in the world. Now, the way that happens is because if you can feel God's love, then of course that's a very safe and secure place. You now feel safe and secure in all of your interactions with the world itself, because you're feeling God's love while you're going through the world. It's the times when we don't feel God's love, that's when it's difficult. That's when life's a lot more difficult. So we learn to express our personality in order to maintain our connection with God, our true parent. So that's why we express our personality. That's how one of the ways we maintain a connection with God, by being who we are, by being the person God created us to be, in fact. That's how we connect to God. Is there any questions about that? Paul, you'd like to ask?
I'm mindful with yourself, and especially years ago, I would see you shaking when you interact with different people, especially.
Yep.
And it's like you're very present, and you're present to your fear, I guess, of
yep.
attack, and
yeah,
and but being yourself regardless. So that's
yeah. People criticize it, right? And they think you're weak for doing it, and they worry about you doing it, and they project all this other stuff at you emotionally about doing it. But at the end of the day, it's what you feel. So just do it. Like if you feel scared of someone and you start shaking, just be shake. Do you know what I mean? It's okay.
For sure. And has it been your connection with God which has helped you to just be very present to yourself? And
yeah, because it's certainly at this stage I'm still working on my connection with myself, obviously. You know, I've still got worth issues about valuing myself. But it's primarily, again, like I've said to you, it's primarily my connection with God, my connection with truth, my desire to love that drives me to do what I currently do. Yeah. So that can happen even if you don't love yourself very much. It's good, eh? Let's look at expressing your personality in two ways, though. You've got, firstly, there's being yourself, and then there's sharing yourself. I just would like to talk to you a little bit more about these two things. Being yourself is an act of love to yourself. It is also the way in which you maintain your connection with God if you want one, by being yourself. So being yourself is something you need to do all the time without fail. Just be yourself. That means being yourself in every situation, being who you really are, telling the truth about who you really are, not entering a facade about who you really are. And it's about being you as you are right now, warts and all. All the errors as well as the truths exposed, because the more you can allow the exposure of them, the more rapidly you'll identify the errors, and the more rapidly you'll also identify the good bits. So you just be yourself, warts and all. Now, that's being yourself. You will do that under all circumstances in all situations without fail. Sharing yourself is a bit different. Sharing yourself, you've got to realize that you can give yourself as a gift to other people by sharing yourself. So, if, for example, when you ask me something about my past, I choose to share myself with you, share bits about my past with you. You won't always share yourself with everyone, because some people are dishonoring of you. Some people will attack you when you share yourself. And so you won't share yourself with those people. You will still be yourself, but you won't share yourself. Do you understand the difference? So you will still be your normal self. You'll still be honest, truthful, open, direct, straightforward. You'll still be your personality, your nature, because that's all a part of being yourself. But when it comes to sharing your history or sharing personal thoughts about and feelings about things, you would look at the situation and analyze the situation and go, well, are these people even wanting to hear it? Do they desire to know me? Or are they just here for another reason? And under those circumstances, you would not share yourself. So the reality is that for many of you, I've not shared myself with you. But I am myself with you. Many of you don't know me very well. You think you do because you've heard a lot of conversations and talks, but many of you don't. You prove that through your interactions with me, in fact. Many of you prove it, that you don't know me very well. And with those people, I don't share myself, but I am still being myself. Does that make sense? Yep. And you can do the same. You will share yourself with the people who love you. You will be yourself with everyone. Yep. Liam, thank you.
So in a situation like that, not being yourself as if you were scared of what someone would do if you didn't share something.
Correct.
But then being yourself, you would just say, I'm not prepared to talk about that with you now.
Correct.
Yep.
Yep. So many times can you see that we are thinking we're being ourselves when we're actually sharing ourselves with a person in an attempt to appease them in some way. Yeah. And that's not being ourselves. We're now in an addiction. So yeah. It's definitely not being ourselves. Yeah. So you can see that you get a feel for this the more of God's love that you enters you. You get a feel for what is right here. You can see at the start, it can be quite confusing because what you might do in one situation that looks to everybody else to be identical to another situation might be two completely different things that you do. Many of you have been confused about that with me. You know, why does he do that with that person, but he doesn't do that with me? Why does he not do that with that person, but he does do that with me? What's going on there? And it's because I can feel in any situation when it's important to either just be myself or I can take the additional step of sharing myself. And the additional step is the step of sharing yourself is an act of love. Being yourself is being loving. Sharing yourself is an additional act of love, an additional gift that you give. So obviously this is what sharing yourself is what you're going to need to do with your other half, isn't it? That's going to be a essential part, isn't it, with the other half, sharing yourself, learning how to share yourself. Now, would you share yourself with the other half if every time you did, she attacked you, or every time you did, she abused you, or every time you did, she tried to control you? Would you do it then? No, but you could say to her, look, I can't share myself with you because these are things you do, and that's not good for me to share myself under those circumstances. Give them the opportunity to change that if they want to change that. But in the end, the soulmate relationship is going to be the second most important sharing of yourself. And what's the first? Sharing yourself with God, yeah. Sharing yourself with God. Okay, so everyone clear about the difference between being and sharing? Okay, so expressing our personality in a loving manner is the way to go. Now, this also involves another thing, and that is expressing my emotion. Many of you believe you can be yourself without actually being emotional. And that's not possible. It's not possible. Your emotions are a part of who you are right now. They are the expression of how you feel right now. So isn't that a part of something that should be part of you being yourself? Being what you feel. So if you need to cry, crying is the best thing to do. Not go, try to keep it all down, you know, and suppress it. Because part of being yourself is actually allowing yourself to cry when you need to cry. That's being yourself. Being happy is also part of being yourself, isn't it? There are times when you are happy, so be happy. But don't do this. Don't worry, be happy. Well, what's that doing? That's denying the unhappiness and the worry and being something different, which is creating a facade. So it should be more like worry and worry, or if you're happy, be happy, shouldn't it? Yeah. Alan, thanks.
Yeah, if I wanted to experiment with humour, because I have this addiction with making people laugh.
Yeah.
If I was just with some friends, or with my partner, and I wanted to make them really sad instead of really happy, is that an unloving experiment?
I think so.
Okay.
I think both of them are unloving experiments. Manipulating the emotions of others through one of your actions is an unloving experiment. So if you want a joke because you want a joke, then joke.
Yeah.
But if you want a joke so that you manipulate the emotion of the other person,
yeah,
then that is a manipulation.
Yeah.
And that's not loving.
Exactly. I'm looking at now why I can see where it started in my childhood.
Yep.
But now I'm looking at what does it really look like in my adult life? And I'm thinking of how I can do some experiments in that.
Yeah.
So that was the first wrong experiment I just thought of.
Well, no, that's what I would classify as an unloving experiment. Let's try to make a loving experiment. What would a loving experiment be? You go up to the person, you realize that they want cheering up.
Yeah.
And you feel like, I could cheer them up. I could.
Yeah.
I could. But that's not loving to do, because they need to feel what they feel right now. Mm. So it'd be better if I talk to them about how they feel right now.
Yeah.
Rather than trying to cheer them up. Mm. Does that make sense?
And I notice with you, it's all spontaneity when you joke and that.
Yeah.
There's no planned thoughts or...
No.
You're not setting up a scene around it or...
No, I don't think of hardly anything in advance. I know that sounds strange, but the reality is that I very rarely plan any of my life and I very rarely think of, this is what I'm going to do when I talk to Alan. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
I just do what I feel like doing when I talk to Alan at the time that I talk to him. Mm. And it doesn't matter to me what that situation is or where we are or anything. Sometimes if it's where we are, I might consider, you know, the fact that other people are around and maybe I've got a job to do as well, so I don't do it under those circumstances because there's other things that would be interfered with. But it's rare for me to think in advance or plan in advance to have a certain conversation of a certain kind.
Yeah, and I've noticed that when things are really sad in me, I'll even try to make a joke to people who aren't interested.
Yeah.
Just so I can get away from the real things that I'm suppressing.
Bothering you.
Yeah.
So, you know, you do have a playful nature, but so does every soul actually.
Yeah.
And quite frequently though, you're using the playful nature to modify your environment.
Yeah.
Which is the facade in play.
Yes.
Yeah. Remember, the point of the facade is to get things from other people that we wouldn't get normally. Yeah. So what I do with you is I just let you be what you are right now with me. So if that's crying, then you're crying. If that's laughing, then you're laughing. You know what I mean? I don't feel I have to do something to modify that in you. Mm. So that's how I am with Mary at home, you know. I don't try to make her laugh or make her cry. I just whatever it is that I feel is... I just be what I am. We don't plan anything.
About a month ago, I connected with some fear that if I don't be my comical self, because I still believe that's myself, that I'll lose a part of me and that I'll fade away to something.
I went through a real bad period where I felt I'd lost all my sense of humour. You know, I was feeling my pain. I had a lot of terror and I was feeling pain, and that went on for a few years like that, you know, where I was feeling pain and feeling terror, and it felt, and I've even said it once to Mary, I think, where I said, I can't remember what my sense of humour looked like or felt like anymore, you know. But that's, you get over that. You do. You go sort of through that.
Yeah. Well, thanks a lot.
Yeah. Liam, thank you.
Is there times when being emotional can also be sharing yourself with people?
Certainly.
So there are times when you may have to, in situations, withhold the emotion until you're by yourself to be able to experience it.
Yeah, but if you loved yourself, you would exit the location immediately.
Okay.
If it was in your power to do so.
Yeah.
Wouldn't you?
Yeah.
Yeah, because obviously your priority would be to feel the emotion. So you wouldn't store emotion for later. So, but there are times, like for example, I was with Pilate in the first century. Remember in the Bible, it says that he asked me what is truth and all those things. And after a while, I became silent. I didn't say anything. I couldn't exit the situation. I was captive, but I didn't have to say anything either. It's the same with the Sanhedrin, with the Jewish Sanhedrin in the first century. When I stood before them, I finished up not saying anything. I made a few comments at the beginning, and then due to the ridicule and the different amounts of anger and rage, they weren't going to allow me to express myself or be myself. And so I felt like the best thing to be is just not say anything at all. So I did. Does that make sense? Because the situation, no matter what I said, just made it worse. So it's better to not say anything at all.
Thanks. Mm.
If we come to Diane down the front, thanks.
Can I share something?
No, Diane. Sorry, you can't. Oh. No sharing here.
Oh, okay.
No, I'm not joking either. No, it's just we've got too much material to cover to spend time sharing stuff. So that's all right.
Thank you.
Okay, you want to go to Glenda, who had her hand up to?
If there's a situation where you can't feel the emotion right then and there,
yep.
What's the method of getting that emotion back?
When you say you can't, is it you can't because you're afraid of other people, or you can't because you can't connect to your own emotion?
No, in my situation at work, if there's an emergency, you have to deal with the emergency. So there might be emotions coming up, but I've still got to carry on with...
Yeah, see, if it was a loving work environment, they'd let you feel your emotion while you carry on with your work. See, that's treated as unprofessional nowadays, isn't it?
Yes.
Yeah. So, but that's out of harmony with love.
At times there are things you just have to do.
Yes, but it doesn't stop you from feeling about them.
No, okay.
So let's say you had a shotgun trauma come in, in a hospital, and he's such a mess that you just feel like crying, so you'd be crying while you're doing it. Because you're allowed to feel. You still would do, because you still want to help him. But you can feel while you're doing. But see, that's treated as unprofessional nowadays, so they don't let you do that. So what you finish up doing is storing that emotion and then finding it very, very difficult later to release it. So now what have you done? You've stored some pain which now has not been released. So it's actually completely the opposite of what God's designed you to do. So this is where some laws need to change, obviously, don't they? Some, what's professional behaviour, what's unprofessional behaviour as a definition needs to change. If you're in harmony with being yourself, you'd let yourself cry while you're doing the work. So you wouldn't be inefficient doing the work. You still let yourself cry while you're doing the work. And if you got berated for that and you lost your job because of that, you'd still do it.
Yeah, I'm not sure I would lose my job. I'd be offered counselling.
So what you say to the counsellor is, yeah, I've already dealt with that emotion. I cried it when I was there. Don't need your assistance. That's why I did it that way. Yeah. Yeah, there's a lot of problems, isn't there, in the world. But let's look at another issue that I'd like to raise with you before we close this particular discussion of being yourself. Myself is not my self, it's Mary and I self, isn't it? Yourself is not your individual self, but rather you and your soulmate self. So when we say, be my loving self, we're actually saying that we need to learn to be for the both of what is the amalgamation of the two of us. Now, can you see that if I have a lot of gender-based blockages towards the opposite gender, I'm not doing that. I'm not going to ever be myself. Because of those gender-based blockages, I will also not allow the other half of me to be herself. So not only am I shutting down ourself, our single self, which I suppose it didn't make much sense from an English perspective, but you get what I mean from a soulmate perspective. Instead of shutting down myself, I am open to experiencing myself and experiencing my other half of myself. Now, what I notice is the majority of you are not doing that. You're not open to experiencing the other half of yourself. You're trying to control the other half of yourself, get them to be what you want them to be, hope that they are what you want them to be, blocking them completely, like just shut off to them completely for many of you. Completely shut off. You can't ever come to be your loving self fully without opening up to that the other half. And I keep referring to the other half so you know what we're talking about. Remember, from God's perspective, you are one being. Right? You are one being. From your perspective, you are... you're like this. That's your perspective for many of you. Or... you think you're one being. You think you yourself are one being, and you're not. The problem with that is it makes you closed off to the other half, completely closed down. You can't become your full loving self like that, closed down. You have to open up. You notice in the outline I've given you quite a lot of things about this under the sections. The choice to remove my personal barriers to my other half. And then I've got a section, my choice to connect to the other half. So it's done in two phases. One is removing my barriers to the other half. Now, most of our barriers are because of this, aren't they? Because of the pain and the facade and my fear and my terror, my false beliefs. These create barriers with my other half. But even if you get rid of all that, you still are going to need to do another thing, and that is to make a choice to connect to the other half. Make a choice to be open to feeling and experiencing their emotion. Does that make sense to you? Yeah. So that is something that we also need to choose to do. Now, many of you feel that you could ignore that. You almost go like this. You almost say to yourself, my relationship with God is my relationship with God. I don't have to involve the other half of me in that. But the reality is the other half's automatically involved in that because you're one soul. You're not this. You're not that experiencing a connection with God. Let's say God's up there. And you're not that experiencing a connection with God at all. Because, in fact, if you try to be that experiencing a connection with God, you won't have a connection with God. So what I notice in a lot of New Age circles, for example, they have women's groups, men's groups. It's ludicrous. Why? Because there's only half of you there. The other half's somewhere else. And you're not even feeling about them, validating them or acknowledging them in any way. You're not being yourself while one half of you is there. Nina, you would like to ask?
So if I'm receiving God's love, what impact might that have on my other half? What's likely to happen for them under those circumstances?
Well, isn't the design of the soul like this? So let's rub that out. That's the untrue design. So this is God, not assuming God. God's a long way away initially, right? So here's us, right? Now, if I start having a true longing for God's love, that means my soul, of which I am one half, is now having a bit of God's love in it. Does it not?
That's pretty cool.
Right?
When you think about it, that's really loving.
It is. However, you're thinking about it a bit in a utopian way, because what's the problem? I have created a separation. Between the two halves. So when this now half starts feeling God's love, what happens?
It fills up my half and doesn't get to the other half.
Well, it's not going to fill up much either, is it? Because it's out of harmony with God's truth. So you're only going to fill up as much as you're in harmony with God's truth. But can you see the problem? If you're not connecting with the other half, you're not going to receive much love for a start, because you're out of harmony with God's truth about soulmates, you're out of harmony with God's truth about the intergender relationships. You've probably got quite a lot of these addictions going on, right, in that place. But the other problem you have is that you're going to be limited in the amount of love you can receive. And this is what is one of the primary limitations for many of you. You're so blocked to the other half of yourself that God's saying, well, hang on a sec, you're in condemnation of the other half of yourself. How can you receive more love from me? You can't while you're in that state, because you're out of harmony with truth in that state. What's going on in those clogs?
The clogs. The thought of opening to God and then including my other half in that process.
Yes, opening to God requires the opening to the other half.
Yeah.
Interesting, hey?
Yeah.
Many of you have thought that's not the case. The reality is, a person, before they can become a celestial spirit, before they can become at one with God, must have completely opened to the other half of themselves, whether the other half of themselves is open to them or not. Many of you don't want to open to the other half of yourself unless the other half opens to you first. In other words, you want control. You don't want to love somebody without them loving you back. And that's not love, that's barter. Right? To become at one with God, you must have completely opened to your whole soul. Which means opening, removing all of the damage related to the other half. Can you see that? That's a part of being your loving self. And unless you do that, you're not your loving self. Many of you have gone into survival mode with this. You feel a lot of pain associated with the other half, that you will never meet them, and you know, and you've got a lot of addictions with the other half, wanting them to meet certain things inside of you. And so you've created this barrier, and then you're wondering why you can't receive God's love. And all you're going to receive love from there is not God. It won't be God. It'll be women spirits so if you think you're being loved from God in that state, no, it's women spirits. In this case, if you're a woman doing that, it'll be women spirits who approve of your actions. If you're a man doing that, it's probably men spirits approving of your actions, and that's all you're really feeling. But God doesn't approve of that action, because God wants you to be your real self that he created. And your real self is both of you, together, one.
It's an interesting way to start living your day, that you're to become more cognizant of the fact that you're a half. And
Yeah, well, I remember one of the very few times that I got some messages from my spirit friends about my own progress was one time when they told me that I was still blocking my other half. And it was way, way back. It was 2006 or 7, so 10, 11 years ago. They told me that I was blocking the other half because I was refusing to feel my grief associated with the loss of the other half. And that was blocking my other half, and that was also blocking my connection with God. So I need to open up to that emotionally. Lots of grief started coming up when I opened up to that emotionally.
Yeah, I noticed when you wrote on the board, my other half, I felt this sense of sadness or something very subtle and soft.
Most of us feel extreme amounts of anger, fear and sadness when it comes to the other half.
So just open up and allow all of that. Thank you.
If we go Glenda and then Joanne on this side.
Yeah, I've always told myself I had a lot of other things to feel before I worried about my soulmate.
Yes, I've heard that story. Yeah.
So what you're saying, being at least open to a soulmate, is part of all this deconstruction.
And a lot of emotions are going to come up, Glenda, that you have towards men that you've been choosing to suppress by saying, "I'll put all that off to later." Does that make sense? And that's one of the things that we sort of let ourselves off the hook for processing a certain amount of quite damaging emotions.
Well, it feels like self-development before I worry about anyone else.
Self-development is development of the whole self.
Whole
self. This whole concept that your self-development is just about your half is flawed from the beginning. And you can't develop yourself anyway, your half of yourself, unless you remove the blockages to the other half. So you're even fooling yourself thinking that you can develop your half if you retain blockages to the other half. You follow?
Yeah.
Mm. Yep. If we come across to Joanne.
If you're with a partner who's very significant, but you're not sure, you don't know if he's the soulmate.
Sorry, you're with a partner who's what did you say? Significant.
I'd have to tell a whole long story to explain.
I would suggest every partner is significant.
Okay.
Enough for you to actually be in a partnership with them.
All right. That was probably an unnecessary statement.
Yeah,
then.
I think so. Go
okay.
On.
And I don't know if he's my soulmate or not.
Yep.
But should I still behave towards him as if I was his soulmate until I know for sure that he's not?
Should I behave towards him?
So not expect him to act towards
me. Reanalyze your question. Should I behave towards him? What are you saying? What are you saying there? Should I behave towards him?
Should I assume that I am his soulmate?
No, I don't see why you should assume that, no.
Until I know.
What you said, though, not that. You've now rephrased it, and I want to look at your original phrasing because it tells you a lot, actually. You said...
Should I behave towards him as if?
So what is that doing? Determining to behave towards someone a certain way in advance is what?
It's a facade.
Exactly. Exactly.
Yep. Okay.
So what you should be is?
Loving.
No, yourself.
Myself, yes.
But there is a tendency to behave a certain way with somebody, assuming that's not being yourself. Doesn't matter whether he's your soulmate or not, you're still not being yourself. If you're not being yourself, if he's your soulmate, is he going to be very attracted to that? Probably not.
No. Right. So that would tell me.
Well, no, because you're already modifying your behaviour. So my suggestion first is to remove the desire to modify your behaviour.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Just be myself.
Be you. Be you as you are right now, warts and all.
Okay. Yes.
See what happens.
Yeah.
Take the risk. All Dive right. in that pool.
Yeah.
It's all cold. Yeah. You know, the dive in.
Yeah. I hope to do that soon. Done it again.
You know what was wrong with that. I would suggest there's not much hope if you're only going to do it soon. The key is to do it now. Why put anything off? There's no much point putting anything off, is there?
That's true.
Just do it now. Don't work up to it. See, working up to it is all about fear, isn't it? Which is the driving force for your facade.
Yep. Okay.
So working up to it is just pandering to the fear. Wouldn't you be better off just diving in? I'm going to be myself with my other half, with the person I'm living with, right from now on, everything, warts and all. Tell them exactly what I think, what I feel in every situation. And if we have fights, we have fights. If we have arguments, we have arguments. I work out, why am I arguing and fighting about all this? I'll work through my different things, the different unloving behaviours I have, the different expectations and addictions that I have. I need to work through these things, but I definitely do not want to behave in a certain way by choice.
Yeah, yeah, no, I see
because that
now.
That is our facade at work.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Yep. Good question though. Kelly.
So how is it that when we meet, if we're in fully addiction pretty much?
Well, there's some of real self and some addiction, right. Isn't there? Usually there's a smidgen of real self. Right. Not always, but...
Yeah, not much when we met.
Fair enough.
Well, if we're soulmates.
Well, I don't know. When I see you guys now, like I see a bit of your real self and I see a bit of your real self. So I suggest to you, yeah, there are some people that I meet that I feel like I can't feel any of their real self.
Okay.
And with you guys, it's not like that. So I can feel a little bit of your real self. So I suggest that a little bit of your real self has had a part to play in you being together.
Okay.
Can I miss that?
Yeah. So when we did meet, how was it that in all, you know, so much addiction, that was the strongest pull that we met?
Well, your addictions are a very strong prayer, are they not?
So is that a loving law of God's that we still were able to meet out of our law of attraction?
No, you're meeting each other to deal with your addictions. That's the loving law.
So, okay, yes.
The law of attraction is at work, pulling people together who are meeting their addictions. Eventually those addictions will be unsatisfied, purified. Which is what's happened in your relationship.
Yep.
Starts off all right and then all of a sudden things start happening where you're not satisfying each other and you start exposing your addictions. This is very good. That's exactly what God wants to have happen.
Yes.
Right? Mm. So that's why it happened. So people often say to me, like I got an email the other day from somebody who knows me a while and obviously don't know me very well, but because they wouldn't ask the question otherwise, but they said, I met this lady 4 months ago and I really want to continue with the divine love path, but she doesn't want to. Right? She doesn't want to. She doesn't want to look at herself and look at her emotions and feelings. What should I do? Now that sounds like a pretty innocent email, doesn't it? Wow. Can you see? It sounds like an innocent email. It's very interesting. I found that email. Because the person themselves is already not practicing God's truth. Because what they'd just be doing is being themselves, no matter what she wanted to do. If they were practicing God's truth, they would just be themselves and see what happened. Whether the other person wanted to practice it or not, it's immaterial. They would just be themselves. Do you follow? And why does he email me about it? Because he wants me to give him some advice about how to not be himself and retain the relationship while at the same time not having to work through this issue of whether she wants or has a desire to even grow, to even be loving. Now, would you choose to be with your soulmate if your soulmate chooses to be unloving? Of course, you probably wouldn't, would you? You would wait until your soulmate chooses to be loving. This is why there's many celestial spirits without the soulmates, because they're waiting for their soulmate to want to be loving. Does that make sense? But they don't try and force their soulmate to be loving. And they don't try and manipulate their own behavior in order to make their soulmate be loving. They don't try to be someone else that their soulmate wants them to be in order to get together with their soulmate. They don't do any of those things. They know that the best way to be with their soulmate in the long run is to be themselves, engage their desires and passions, because that is the other half's desires and passions as well. That is the expression of the other half. And eventually, once the other half gets past their self-hatred and self-loathing and all these other things that cause them to want to reject that, they'll eventually accept that and love it. So that's what we need to do.
Thank you.
All right, well, I've gone way over time, so I need to stop. So that we can have our last conversation. I gave you a bit of extra time there because we have no Q&A on that particular subject, so I thought we needed to just, and there are a few more questions in that particular subject. What we're going to do now is have a... That's the finish of our my choice to be loving self, my loving self. And my suggestion is send in some more questions that you have about that. Look at the outline again and ask some questions. And what we'll do is we have a 10-minute break, so we can come back at 3:20 and we'll get started with our last item on the program.